it's overwhelming, but it's also our jobs.
Our job is only going to get harder.
It's worrisome.
This is something that's unprecedented.
Now is not the time to be a cowboy. No one has anything to prove. We're all in this together.
Welcome to Reporting from the Frontline of the Pandemic. I'm Natalie Clydesdale, and I'm here with Chloe Teboe, a reporter at News Center Maine in Bangor, Maine. Thank you, Chloe, for joining me.
Yeah, thank you for having me.
My first question is, how have you had to adjust the way that you work throughout the coronavirus pandemic?
So we've had a lot of adjustments with this job, and it's been pretty unprecedented. So every day we're kind of taking it step by step. I work for a company called Tegna, and they basically made the decision nationwide to have reporters and field crews work from home. So I haven't been inside of our newsroom in like 5 or 6 weeks now at this point. And we've basically been trying to avoid doing stories in person because we just don't want to contaminate people or get contaminated. Our goal is kind of to try to keep everyone healthy and just follow the governor's guidelines. So I've been doing all of my interviews remotely on Zoom or FaceTime, which is pretty weird. I think one reason I like this business is meeting people and getting to go out and do stories and be interactive. And so it's taken a lot of different kind of creativity to figure out how to put together packages and visuals by just sitting at my kitchen table right here every single day.
What have you been using for B-roll for your packages?
So that's kind of depended. If I am doing a story where I can shoot generic B-roll of buildings or something, I'll do that just to kind of go outside and keep doing shooting, and try to get like new visuals. But for a lot of our stories, we pull file video, and we just have to make it clear that it is file video because some of them show people who aren't social distancing 6 feet apart. So we want to make it apparent to our viewers that that was from a certain point in the past. I'm trying to think, what else have I used? I also, we have to get creative with graphics. I think that's a big part now. So I've learned how to build graphics pretty well. Doing stuff just on my computer, trying to do interactive and kind of creative edits, just filming in my apartment. I did a story about like FaceTime and Zoom, so that I was, calling my parents, using my phone and cutting different shots. It's been really weird. And that's probably the hardest part, is trying to make a story still visually interesting when you really don't have much opportunity to shoot anything.
Yeah, I'm sure that's a big challenge. What other types of precautions has the station taken for anyone who does have to go in?
So we are trying to limit the number of people as much as possible. And News Center Maine is kind of unique. Like we're a statewide news organization. So we have a Portland newsroom and then we have a Bangor newsroom. And in Bangor, there's no one there except for reporters and then a couple of marketing people. So I'm up in the Bangor newsroom and it hasn't been that different for me. I'm just not allowed to go in the building anymore. And the only person allowed there is one of our technical guys who's there in case something goes wrong, basically. But then in Portland, like even when we're working regularly, we're always sending our stuff down to Portland to be broadcast like around the state. And so they've had to take kind of more drastic measures because everyone there has basically left the building except for we have one producer who's in the booth during the shows. We have the director who's there, and I'm talking about the morning show because I don't know exactly what the evening show is. Then let me see. I mean, even editors, like they were in the building for a while. They've moved out now. They're working from home. This week we moved our two morning show anchors into the studio because we have two separate sets, so they can stay on different sets and still be practicing social distancing. But I think at a time, we only have like 6 people max in the building, which is obviously not a lot.
Yeah, how has everyone adjusted to that overall? Like how has the newsroom adjusted?
Yeah, it's been weird. Like I said, I feel for me, I was kind of already in a position that was a little bit odd just because I work for the morning show and we're a pretty tight-knit group, but I'm the only reporter up in this part of the state for that show. So I'm always alone every single morning, like no matter where I am. So for me, like it just was a matter of, okay, I don't drive 5 minutes into the station, I'll just work at my house. But I know for people down in Portland, you know, when you work in news, you get used to being around a group of people and kind of feeding off of each other's energy. And that's part of the job I think that a lot of us enjoy, and that kind of pushes us through it. So it's especially hard, like in a time right now when this is probably the most difficult period of covering a prolonged story for such a long period of time. We're not together and we're all kind of separate. The reporters up here, like I haven't seen any of them for weeks, which is weird because we usually hang out. So that's the toughest part, I think, is just not being able to have that social interaction every day. So I don't know, but we're going on, I think this is week 6 now. So we're figuring it out. It's just like, it's so weird to be living life like through a virtual lens. Like I haven't interacted with people except through Zoom or FaceTime, which is getting old, but you know.
How have you found your stories?
So that's been something that's been pretty interesting about this whole thing is I feel like the story ideas are just like never ending. Like there's so much to do that you actually feel like overwhelmed by the amount of options and routes you can take. So that's just like coming up with ideas off the top of your head based on viewer questions you might get and emails. But we also get emails sometimes. I've gotten messages before just about things that people are really interested in seeing. And I think something that's so interesting about covering the news in a pandemic is viewers are a lot more apt to send us questions and concerns they have because everyone's kind of living in this period of unknowns and we want answers. So in that sense, like, I guess that's been, I don't want to say like the positive, but it hasn't been hard to come up with story ideas just because there's so many options, they never kind of dry up. So
yeah, I keep seeing on social media that people are blaming the coronavirus on the media and saying that the media are the ones blowing everything out of proportion. And what's your response to that?
It's frustrating, like, when you do this every day, and, you know, that's not even, like, a national rhetoric. It's local, too. Like, it's everywhere, and I don't know exactly why that is. Obviously, I'm pretty new working this field, so I don't know if, you know, the media is the problem narrative has always been as strong as it is right now. But I guess really a response, like all we're doing is covering the facts, and you can see every story that we do, you know, I'm talking to people who are working in the midst of it, whether it's a doctor, whether it's someone, you know, on the front lines providing food to people who are out of jobs. And so I don't think it's about, you know, the media creating fear. We're running with like the slogan, you know, facts, not fear, because we're just talking to professionals, trying to get the information out to people without, you know, creating any havoc. So I don't know. It's just, it's frustrating to be in this job and to work really hard every day and then to still get comments like that. But what we have tried to do to, you know, kind of back off of like the facts, not fear, is just to keep like a calm presence and try to mix in, you know, lighter stories that we're doing with the stories about the facts and about the numbers. We've really been trying not to, you know, drill the numbers every day into people's heads. We'll cover them, but we don't want that to be like our leading newscast. So we try to kind of get a mix of everything just to keep it kind of well-rounded.
What has your favorite story been? Like your favorite happy story been?
I've had quite a few because the morning show you get to do more of those, which is nice. But I had one in particular because we had so many people reach out about this. It's a group that was started in Brewer, which is the town right across from Bangor. It's like a 5 minute drive away. And this guy started this Facebook group called Quarantine Karaoke. So he basically was like in his basement one night, like recording a song just for fun, and he posted it online and people really got a kick out of it because it was at the beginning of this self-quarantining. So he was like, you know, why not create a group where people can just post videos for fun. It can be kind of a way to connect while we're all separated. So he did that, and then within a week, it had more than 250,000 members, and now it has more than 500,000 members from, like, countries all around the world, like, basically every single continent. And so it's been really cool to see how much it's grown, and just, like, how, I don't know, like, how comfortable people are. Like, I've, obviously, when I was doing this story, I was scrolling through to see, you know, what people were posting, and it really is this nice community where people are there to kind of be together in a way, and to support each other. And then I basically did a follow-up, I think it was last week, because he decided to start, like, making t-shirts. He partnered up with someone from Bangor, and they are giving that money, you know, they wanted to keep it local since this group was started by someone who was local. So they're giving it to the Bangor Area Homeless Shelter because they've been seeing a lot more need just in terms of supplying food to people. So that was probably the nicest one. And you do, I think that situations like this, they're so difficult, but at the same time, it does bring out kind of the good in people, which is really nice to see as well.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's awesome. So, kind of switching gears here, what is your advice for anyone looking to get into the broadcast journalism industry, especially during these times?
Ooh, I know, that's tough. I would say, just in general, my advice, it would probably be don't be afraid to, like, take a route that you may not have anticipated going on, like, to begin with. I think Marcia mentioned this, but I started off, I was actually, Carly doesn't have, Carly's producing, I was digital content producing, so I was working, like, online, and that was never, like, I always wanted to be a reporter and be on air, but I took that job for one reason, just because I wanted to work in Portland for a while, and live at home to save money. But then it also, I think it's just good to learn a lot of different skills in this field because they all go so hand in hand. And I think that just really kind of boosted me up, like when a reporting position opened up, just to move into that and have this other knowledge kind of at my fingertips. So I would say, you know, it doesn't hurt to try like a different position. And especially right now, like trying to work that into the coronavirus angle, I know that it is hard. Like a lot of places, I know Tegna's not hiring right now just because they don't have the money to do that. It's actually like, this is public knowledge, but Tegna has decided countrywide that every employee has to take like a week off of furlough. So like, we're not getting paid for a week. We can't do any work for a week. And that's because, you know, we are a publicly owned company. We rely on advertisers and they're taking a hit right now as well. So I guess my advice to you guys would be just to be prepared, keep working on your material. I mean, we are going through a huge period in history. So even if you want to do work on your own to try to find stories and create some kind of portfolio while we're in the midst of this pandemic, because it's really unprecedented and we haven't seen anything like it before. But yeah, that would be my advice. I guess also don't be afraid to like move somewhere new either. Like that's something that's kind of difficult about this business, is it can be hard to find the job like exactly where you want to be right when you want to be there. For me, like I wanted to move back to Maine just to be near my family, which has been nice, but Bangor's about 2 hours away from them, so it's kind of a new environment. And it has been nice just to see a different part of the state that I have never been in before, so.
Yeah. Well, is there anything else you want to add about anything, the virus or the journalism industry in general?
I'm trying to think. I don't think so. Yeah, those are pretty, like, well-rounded questions. I don't think there's anything else to touch on. But yeah, that would be my advice. And, you know, just, like, reach out to people, too. I think Emerson has such a good network of people who are in the industry that it never hurts to just like message and try to get advice from people. Also watch other people's stories too. That's something that I think is really valuable. Like people who have been at the station for a long time, wherever you end up working, it's nice to watch and to learn from people and to try to emulate them. And yeah, I guess that's it.
Yeah. Well, thank you, Chloe, for taking the time to talk to me, and thank you for the work you're doing to keep us informed and safe. And thank all of you for watching this episode of Reporting from the Frontline of the Pandemic. I've been talking with Chloe Teboe, a reporter at News Center Maine in Bangor, Maine. I'm Natalie Clydesdale.